Are you working? What kind of work do you do?
Welcome into another midweek podcast. We have a special guest joining us today on the program, Joey Holcomb, assistant coach at South Carolina. In his first year, came over from Campbell, the program we're really fond of. But Joey, we're excited to welcome you onto the midweek podcast here today. How's everything going for you?
It's great. It's great. I'm happy to be with you guys. You know, this time of the year, it's a little bit slow in the baseball world, so I'm glad to be able to hop on here and talk to you guys about some baseball.
Yeah, Coach, I'll start with it. First off, once again, thank you for coming on the podcast. We really appreciate it. I'll just start because I think if people are listening to this podcast, they're either a college baseball fan or they're a Campbell Camels fan. So they're familiar with you or the Campbell offense and the kind of numbers you guys put up. Just to read off a few to start, because I think it's worth mentioning because how preposterous it really was, 2023. 318 batting average as a team, ninth in the nation, or led the nation, excuse me, on base percentage with a 439, second in slugging, third in runs, seventh in home runs. That's pretty darn good for a school out in Bowie's Creek. So you obviously had a big hand in doing that and getting the players there as well and helping coach them. Can you kind of talk about your general hitting philosophy or some core principles you have when it comes to hitting?
Yeah. I mean, you can go pretty deep down that rabbit hole, but the surface level of it is that everything is really kind of approached base. And like with less than two strikes, we consider ourselves to be in the driver's seat. And so we swing if we feel like we can do damage, you know, and that, you know, that kind of goes down into the next layer of like hunting certain pitches, hunting certain lanes, whatever. And that is the guy on the mound has a plan for how he wants to attack you and get you out. And you have to have a tool in your toolbox to be able to counter what he wants to do. And if you don't have that, then you're gonna be in trouble. And so, like, we train those tools to be able to counter what that guy on the mound is trying to do. And, you know, that's a process of eliminating pitches, of hunting lanes, like I said. And then there, like, once you have less than two strikes, I'm hunting those pitches in those lanes. And if I get it, like, I'm putting a swing on it that can do some real damage. You know, if I swing at a pitch with less than two strikes, it's because I think I can hit it 105 or better. And if I can't, then I take it. And then when we get to two strikes, it's battle like hell and compete. That's really kind of it in a nutshell. You know, how we train those things is we go at it from a ton of different angles, but that's the core principle.
All right. Are you guys a big like live rep kind of approach? Like I know for like Will and I did not hit in college, but we did pitch, but we had a lot of heavy stuff like that where like all our hitters were just hitting off machines or live arms pretty much every day.
Yeah, like I'm a proponent of like training like game speed, if not more, as often as possible. You know, like we hit off the machines a ton. Every single day where you're going to see some form of velo, some form of spin, some form of two strikes. And so we make sure we check those boxes every single day. But when we set up these velos and we set up these breaking balls, like they're not average pitches. Like our goal is to try to set up environments that are extremely challenging for our guys so that when they step in the box, like they're not overwhelmed by anything. You know, a prime example is like you're talking about Campbell. In my first year, was that 2 years ago when we were in the Tennessee regional, like we match up against Dolander from Tennessee, you know, SEC pitcher of the year, like unbelievable number. So I think we ended up getting him out in like the third or fourth inning, which was the shortest outing of the year. And he had great stuff, unbelievable stuff. But like the way that we had been training our dudes was like they were getting them box and it was 95 and, you know, they're coming back to the box, they're coming back to the dugout. And like, you know, like it's okay. Like it's nothing crazy.
Yeah. I wish I could say that if I was going to face Chase Dolander, but it's nothing. 95. Oh, it's free cheese.
Yeah, I mean, when we hit off a fastball, like fastball machine, like that's kind of our average fastball machine.
There you go. Kids listening at home, buy a pitching machine.
Yeah.
That's important training that you talk about, Coach. And when we talk about you coming over from Campbell to now being in your first year at South Carolina, talk a little bit about what that transition process has been like for you.
Yeah, it's been 100 miles an hour. So we you know, we played in the South Carolina regional. You know, it was interesting. I was at NC State before Campbell. NC State was the 3 seed, matching up with them, then playing against South Carolina in the championship game. And you get done, you go back, and then it's like you start you move out of that mindset of season mode, trying to, you know, prepare for games to, okay, like, let's get into the recruiting mindset. And so, you know, Hare always likes to give the guys, you know, like, let's a week off, no recruiting, like, get back, recharge, enjoy your family a little bit before you guys hit the road. And so I was still, you know, I was kind of taking advantage of those couple of days, and then got a phone call, you know, and about the South Carolina situation, and led to some more phone calls, you know, accepted the position, and then like everything kind of sped up. You know, I was really ready to hit the ground running. Like, so I was trying to move as fast as possible, find a house, get the family, you know, where's the kids going to go to school. And then also balance the recruiting side too. You know, like what events are going on? What is the current and future rosters look like? What are the needs? You know, talk to some coaches. You know, I tried to, you know, it, as much as you would like to say, you are recruiting a little bit different of a player from Campbell to South Carolina. So, you know, like trying to make sure that the guys that I were aware of had those capabilities, had that ability to play in the SEC, you know, and then build my recruiting database too to find more, you know, SEC caliber guys.
Okay, so Coach, I have a real question, but I'm gonna ask a little bit more of a silly question first, because you mentioned that I didn't even think about this, but it seems relevant considering coaches and players and people like that move all the time. What is buying a house like in that kind of, like, you start July 1st and you have to like find a house? How hectic is that? Because you've been out to, this is not your first time, like, you know, moving to a different school and new job, like. How hectic is that? How do you even go about doing that?
If you're single, it's not a big deal at all. If you have family and kids, it becomes, there's a lot of puzzle pieces that have to fit in, and you have to prioritize, like, okay, this is the most important puzzle piece. Let's figure that out. So for me, it was okay. Like, let's start establishing, like, what are, like, schools, what are the schools that we would be interested in sending our kids, you know, to get to go, like, the, and then we have a 3-year-old. So then you have to start thinking about daycare availability. So, like, you can't just say, well, that's a good daycare, because they may not have any openings for this. Yeah. So, like, then you have to figure out, well, who has availability for daycare? You know, logistically, what does that look like? Then it's like, okay, my wife traveling to her job, me traveling to my job. And then you kind of settle in, okay, like, this is the area where we need to be. And then you start talking to people, like, okay, like, in this area, what are some of the better neighborhoods? What is within our price range? So there's a lot of puzzle pieces that have to fit together.
There you go. That is stressful right there. I'm just hearing you talk about that. I don't have a wife or kids or anything. I'm just sitting at home right now. So to the more real question, it's also kind of a two-parter in its own right. So first part is, how is Carolina so far different than your other stops from like Campbell, NC State, and Greensboro? And then the second part of that too is, because we talked a little bit off camera beforehand, we're talking about you getting to meet Ethan Petrie for the first time. What is it like just seeing those guys for the first time once you get on campus? What's your kind of approach to getting to a new place and evaluating the hitters they have already there?
Yeah. So the first part of the question, the difference is, are you talking about the programs or the areas where in the moving?
Sorry, programs. My bad.
Programs. You know, each one of them are they have their differences and they have their similarities. You know, honestly, like NC State, it was awesome. Loved it. I would say all of them are pretty close to the same. You know, I think like to my time at NC State, like the biggest piece is individualized player development. So a lot of things that take place on the field at practice, whatever, are trying to help advance each individual player. And it was the same way as at Campbell, like really hang your hat on player development. And once I've got here to South Carolina, it's really the same thing. So all three of my stops there have been kind of the same philosophy. If you can continue to develop each individual player, then the product you're going to put on the field is going to be better. So all of them have been very similar in that aspect. And like when you get to a new place and you're watching these players and trying to kind of figure out, you know, like it's just baseball. Like it is baseball. Like you can go into it and kind of mentally overwhelm yourself, but the truth is it's just baseball. Like it's something I've been doing for a long period of time, and I feel pretty confident, you know, in my knowledge of the game. The piece that's different is connecting with the players. For example, like South Carolina had a really good year last year. You know, you're talking about Ethan Petrie, who was extremely successful as a freshman. So you step into these environments and you want to be able to immediately help these players continue to grow. But you can't do that until you earn their trust. And so when you go into these places, you start talking to an Ethan Petrie or a Gavin Casas or a Cole Messina, these guys that are really good, and you start trying to talk to them about helping them. Well, if you want to help them, you're going to start talking to them about their weaknesses. That's just it. Like, you're not going to help a player by trying to make them better at their strengths. You're going to help them by trying to make them more well-rounded and limit their weaknesses. So if you step into an environment and you start talking to someone who's been really successful about areas that they may struggle without having a relationship, they're going to just brush you off and they're not going to listen to you one bit.
Yeah.
And so you have to be able to go in and start building a relationship. And truthfully, you have to balance egos. Like, you can't go head to head, buddy. Like, you have to walk that fine line. And so build that relationship, earn their trust, and it's just giving them little nuggets here and there, and then just let it continue to grow from there until they like, okay, like, I'm bought in. This guy can help me. He's not trying to criticize me. He's trying to help me. And then they will start listening.
Okay. I like that. Build slow. It works out.
I love that answer. I'm with Charlie. I like that too, because it is interesting. But that's one thing, Joey, that you have a lot of experience with is going to a new environment and breaking it down really quickly. You talk about, 2 years at Campbell, and there you get a guy who's now in the major leagues after your first year there. And then, like Charlie mentioned at the beginning of the podcast, you had a record-setting offense from a season ago that you were able to help lead the charge in that facet last year. One thing I want to ask, because Charlie brought this up too, is the movement process going from Campbell to South Carolina. Was that crazier, or was going from NC State after what was, the World Series appearance that you had in 2021 that was canceled and much controversy, going to Campbell after that? Because you're a part of that staff in 21, and then you're a part of the Campbell staff.
Yeah.
Talk about each transition, because both of those are fascinating.
I didn't make the move to Campbell until I think like August, so it was the back end of the summer. Oh, so I had every intention. There was some job opportunities that came up during that summer, but like nothing really worked out, was the right fit. And then, I knew the Campbell position was open. And I've known Coach Hare, just from recruiting and being around him on the road, and know about, the program and the trajectory that is going. And so I'd heard that they were interviewing some people, didn't really think I was a part of that process. Then I got a phone call and I'm like, well, this is a no brainer. Like, honestly, like, you're going to go into a program, and I'll be honest with you. Like, one of the knocks, like, so I was at UNC Greensboro to start out my career in North Carolina. I played Division III, started coaching Division III in Alabama. And then I had the opportunity to go be the volunteer with Link Jarrett at UNC Greensboro. And I always wanted to get my foot in the door Division I, but the way that Division I works is that if you don't have Division I playing experience or coaching experience, if you don't have D1 anywhere on your resume, then you're not considered. So here I am. I'm someone that played junior college in Mississippi, played Division III, coached Division III. Like, nothing was in line for me to be able to coach a Division I, even though those were my aspirations. Well, this opportunity came up and I'm like, oh, I got to take it. So I went and I was the volunteer for 3 years at UNC Greensboro. And then my wife and I were like, look, let's give it 3 years. And if nothing happens, we'll move back to Alabama and figure something out. Well, at the end of year three, our recruiting coordinator stepped away from baseball. And then Link asked me to move in that position. So timing, part of God's plan for sure. For the recruiting coordinator for 4 years, we were really successful at UNCG. And then the one piece on my resume was the recruiting. Like, I needed more recruiting experience. I ended up going to NC State, was there for a couple of years. And there were some opportunities. And I know there were some people that reached out, like, inquiring about me for positions. But the question was always like the recruiting piece. He only has 4 years of Division I recruiting. Well, when this job came up, and I'm like, well, like, I need to add more recruiting for Division I on my resume. And like, here's a chance to go be the recruiting coordinator at Campbell, who's going to win 35, 40 games every single year. They're going to win their conference, you know, championship every single year. They're going to be in a regional every single year. Like, it's a no-brainer to be able to put those things on my resume as a recruiting coordinator. Like, it's you don't even have to think about it. And so when I got the phone call and, you know, talked to Hare, kind of went through the interview process, you know, and he offered me the job, I'm like, yeah, absolutely, I'm in. And so that transition, it was actually pretty easy because where I was living when I was driving to NC State every day, I didn't really have to move. Our family was settled. I wasn't trying to find a new house or anything. So I was able to just, instead of driving straight east, I was able to go a little bit further south to get to Campbell. And so the transition wasn't bad at all. It was pretty easy. But moving here, obviously, you know, you got to relocate your entire family, and the kids were a little bit older. So it was much more challenging in that aspect. So, you know, again, like it's coaching baseball, man. It's just going and coaching baseball. The moving the family piece is probably the one that's the most difficult and challenging.
All right, Coach. I can't believe I totally forgot about 2021 and NC State. I remember like where I was when that news broke. I was, oh my God,
that
gets me a little. I mean, you're definitely you should be. I mean, I'm fired up about that, so I can only imagine how you guys are fired up about that still to this day.
And you know, and like you look at what's happening in today's world, like now that we're removed from it after so many years, you know, now it's like, you know, hey, the vaccines didn't work. So,
Coach, we talked a lot about, you talked a lot about coaching so far. And you've mentioned you've been with some very big name, successful coaches in your coaching career to this point. So that's why I like to ask a lot of our coaches this that we have on, because like I always say, nobody starts out in coaching for the money, obviously. So who or what got you into coaching, and who have been like some of your biggest influences on the coach you become today?
Well, you know, honestly, I would say that the one that's impacted me the most has been Link Jarrett now at Florida State. You know, I was with him for 7 years. You know, I coached Division III baseball. I was like, I guess maybe 3 or 4 years, and then had the chance to go up there. And I look back at my overall career, like each man that I've worked for has really kind of influenced me and helped mold me to be the coach that I am today. But Link, because I was with him the longest, probably is the one that had the most influence. And so in terms of like a lot of the foundational offensive pieces, like it was all from him. Like I learned everything from him. In terms of as a manager, as a leader, like he was someone that like he was really good at like questioning things. Like, so like if he taught me to question things, like, you know, you go and you hear someone speak on this drill and do this, like I was all, you know, all in, hey, that's awesome, that looks cool. But like, he taught me to like question, like, really, like, is this what happens in the game? Is it going to help him hit in the game? Like, you know, start really kind of boiling down to, is this what takes place in a baseball game? Cause it's real easy to get caught up in drills and different things like that. And lose sight of what actually happens. And then also like there'd be times where I would say the biggest thing that he taught me was like, as an assistant coach, don't be on the bus just for the ride. Like, be thinking through as if you're the one that's driving the bus, even though you may not be. Don't get on the bus just because you want to go along for the ride. You know, there'd be times where we would pull up. I remember one time we pulled up at the conference tournament practice day. Thursday we have our practice time for an hour. We pull our bus up to the stadium. We're unloading, and he looks at me. He's like, "All right, what are we doing?" You know, and I'm like, "What are you talking about? What are we doing?" He's like, "Yeah, like, what are we doing? Like, we've got an hour. What do you want to do?" And so, like, all he was trying to do was like have me thinking ahead, like always thinking ahead. If I'm the one that's making the calls, or what am I convicted in? You know, don't just be along for the ride. You know, then I go to Coach Avent at NC State, and he was an unbelievable leader. He was a guy that he really like empowered his assistant coaches. Like, it was like the assistant coaches, get these guys ready to play, do whatever it takes. And then when we get to the game, like I'll manage the game, but have these guys ready to play. And he was really, really good at building relationships with players. Like, he was like, guys absolutely loved him. You know, he was always the guy that like he would come in the locker room with like steaks and take them into the locker room and drop them off for guys to, you know, have for dinner that night. Like, he was all like, I think it didn't matter who was on in that program. They could call him at 3 o'clock in the morning and he is coming wherever they are and doing whatever they need him to do. Like sincere, sincere love for those dudes in that locker room. So in terms of building relationships with the players and trusting your assistant coaches, like he was unbelievable, you know, and then going to, you know, Coach Hare was very similar to Coach Avent. Like he really good he was really good at building culture and like that brotherhood that he always talks about, really good at, you know, and you have to, cause you're in Bowie's Creek and there's nothing else there, So you have to lean on each other, you know? And so like you end up building a bond cause you're each other's friend, like you're around each other, not just on the baseball field, because there's nothing else there. You're around each other all the time off the baseball field. So you end up becoming brothers cause you're around each other so much. And so he was really good at building that culture and then trusting his assistants to like do your thing. You know, he was really good. Like if you have a better idea of how to do something, like I'm all ears, let's do it. And he was really good about, like, I don't want to say experimenting, but willing to try unorthodox things just to see if it works.
I like that. That's
Yeah.
All the aspects of coaching, all three of those coaches. Unorthodox. This is not necessarily that unorthodox, but I just love the creativity of it. First thing came to mind was the meat wagon that you guys had at Campbell. I love that thing.
Yeah. That's another thing. I'll say that about here. That's another thing that I feel like that he was really good at, was always forward thinking, like in terms of like what tools, what improvement of the stadiums, what can we do to continue to grow this place to become, like, what is the next step to reach the vision that I have for this place?
Yeah, I like that. That's awesome.
I do too. And one thing that we both liked a lot, Coach, was, I mean, it's interesting how you put it. You know, you're at this ballpark last year, you know, now it's your place of employment and a regional. NC State's there too. It's kind of cool for you, I'm sure. But when we talk about this ballpark, I mean, there's not many venues in the country that a team can excel at the level that South Carolina did, especially to start the season. What was it? They won like 22 of their first 23 games, and they were undefeated at home for about 20 games in a row to start the year. And obviously it was an incredible year. And just to add context to this, is a lot of people may not realize, like, that came after a not so good year in 2022. They had an incredible year last year, but I just want to ask you, like, now coming here and getting ready for 2024, like the facility and the atmosphere of, like, you know, 7,000 plus there, energy packed. How cool is it to go to work at one of the premier venues in the country?
It's cool, for sure. It's cool. You know, like, it doesn't really, like, you know, you go out on the practice field and you're thinking about practice, you're thinking about players, you're thinking about timelines, you're thinking about all these things. Like, so you don't really think about that. When it does come into play is when it's the scrimmage day and we're just scrimmaging. We got a 4-inning scrimmage and you look up and, you know, there's 150 people sitting in the stands and you're just like, what in the world? It's crazy. And then, you know, we finish up with our scrimmage and all these people are like yelling for our players to come get their autographs and shake their hands. And these guys are superstars walking around and it's just, that world is different for sure. And, you know, like, it's one thing that I've never really been a part of is, you know, Columbia, it is a decent sized city, but like everybody is very in tune to what's happening on this campus, very, especially on that baseball field. And so having that kind of environment and those many people paying attention to what's happening is different for sure. So I just hope that we get off to a good start.
I like that you brought that point about Columbia, because like, I do think people forget, this is a little off topic, but like, there's a very big difference to me between, like, I guess every town that has a major college is a college town per se, you know, but like, I always ask, if you take that college out, what is left to the town? I always kind of felt like Columbia is very much a true college town in that kind of sense, where like, people live and breathe Gamecock, baseball, football, basketball, soccer, everything down there.
Yes. It's just, I find it interesting, you know, just, being at football games and people knowing, like, people seeing Monty Lee walk by and Mark Kingston walk by, and you can see, and like, nobody knows who I am. I'm just the guy walking in the back.
They'll know you eventually, Coach.
Yeah, and then just watching everybody, like, kind of pointing and talking, and like, you know, we walk into a restaurant for an official visit, and I see some, you know, some family sitting in there, and they're like, that's Monty Lee, and like, I get cracked up at that kind of stuff.
That's hilarious. I do like that. To go, this goes back to Campbell, I guess, but this really does kind of go for any players. I'm using the Campbell players as the example for this. And I don't know how much you as the assistant coach have like a hand in this, I guess, per se, but what kind of impact do guys like, for example, like Zach Neto or Bryce Arnold have on a program in terms of leadership and just the way they go about their business? Is that kind of a conversation that like Coach Hare would have with like pull Zach aside before they say, hey man, like we know you're gonna be a big contributor for us. Like we need you to like help us communicate to the players and, you know, kind of help lead this team for the whole year.
I'll tell you, I look at last year, like it's almost the culture that they've created. It's not like it's, you know, it's the brotherhood and all that, you know, but the culture that no one knows is the work that goes in. Yeah. You can roll out to those batting cages at 9 a.m. on any day of the week, and there's going to be 2 to 3 guys hitting it all the way up to, you know, start a practice. And so there are guys that work constantly. Jared Belbin was in that cage.
Yes, every single I love day hearing that.
For 45 minutes every single day. Logan Jordan was in there. Lawson Harrill was in there. Like those dudes, they work like crazy. And so what happens is, you know, you come into these programs as a freshman and you see this Lawson Harrill, who is, you know, the conference player of the year, who hit 23 home runs, and, you know, Jared Belbin and Bryce Arnold and Zach Neto, who's projected to be this superstar. And these dudes are in here hitting every single day and, you know, working like crazy. And you're a freshman, you think, well, okay, like they're the, you know, these dudes are the superstars of the program. Like, how did they become it? Well, this is how. Like, so if that's what they do, then that's what I'm expected to do. If I want to be that guy, if I want to be a first round draft pick, this is what they do. So I'm just going to imitate them. So like, it just ends up being, you know, so those dudes start hitting more and more and more and more, and then it just continues to grow and it just doesn't stop. And it's just kind of feeding itself.
Love that. So it's a self-sustaining organism. So I guess another part to that question would be, because I genuinely don't know. I've never been a recruiter or anything. I'm only 24. Yeah. I've not been a coach of any kind other than like for like a powder puff football game back in high school or something like that. So I like you kind of said there, like kids kind of, you kind of buy in if you want to be successful when you get to a program like that. But when you're on the recruiting trail and stuff, like how do you try to find, like I think everybody tries to find guys that obviously fit your program or anything like that. But I feel like if you're watching those guys, you don't get a chance to like know if they actually work hard. Like for all you know, a high school coach is just like, you know, blowing smoke up your ass just to tell you so his kid gets a scholarship, you know. So how do you kind of, are there things you look for to like find kids? Like this kid might be one of these guys that fits the program that's really going to be a grinder? Or is it kind of like, he's a really talented player, he seems like a good kid, he'll probably spy in once he's on campus?
Well, like once you There's some preliminary things, of course, like when you go through, like, you know, the size, like size is important. You always like, you want to recruit big, physical, athletic, baseball athletic guys, good movers. Like there's those things, that those boxes that you want to check. And then once you identify like, okay, this is a candidate, immediately, like you start talking to the summer ball coach, you talk to the high school coach, like you talk to as many people in that player circle as possible to really understand what drives and what motivates them, you know. Whether, you know, the in my opinion, if you don't want to play professional baseball, it's going to be really hard to survive in this game. Like if you're not self-motivated with aspirations of being a first round pick, you're probably not going to hold yourself accountable and work as hard as what's necessary to be, you know, to be an everyday guy at this level. So you talk to as many people as you possibly can to find out, like, what are their goals? What do they work like? Are they showing up early? Are they leaving later? Are they in the cages extra? Are they taking extra ground balls? Whatever. You know, do they really see themselves as being a legitimate draft one day and playing professional baseball? And if yes, then bring them on. If not, then it's going to be hard.
I love that. I agree. I 1,000% agree with that statement right there. I don't think the average fan or person realizes that you kind of, even if you're not going to, even if you know deep down you're not going to play at the next level like that, you still got to train and prepare as if you, like, you're going for that goal. Because I'm a big believer too, and you aim high and you miss high. You know, you can't aim low, because then you're just going to, even if you accomplish it, it's like you don't know how much more potential you had in you.
Yes, I agree.
And here's the thing, though, that you bring up, that you do have some legit first round candidates on your team.
Yeah, that's true too. Like,
so when we talk about this lineup, you talk about Petrie coming back and then Messina and Casas, like that might be the best trio returning in the country right there. You return two All-Americans at your 3-4 hole with Petri and Messina, but I'm looking at the roster, coach. Some of the transfers were kind of exciting me as well. One guy who was at your previous stop, UNC Greensboro. I mean, yeah. This dude in Kennedy Jones with 14 bombs.
Yeah.
And hit 355 in what I understand to be a pretty big ballpark. He hit 25 yes. bombs there in 2 years.
Yes.
And then you get Parker Nolan, who played 4 years at Vandy, Blake big Jackson yet. From Charlotte. I mean, three big time transfers. And then you return three studs already in the middle of your order. I mean, this could be one of the best lineups in the country. Talk a little bit about some of those new guys, coach.
Yeah. Yeah. Like, honestly, those returners, like their last year speaks for themselves, and they're continuing, and those dudes work and they're continuing to get better. And so honestly, like, I think those guys are in a better place right now than they were 1 year ago in the fall. So, you know, the goal is to continue to improve for those guys, and they're working hard to do it. Now, as for the guys who are transferring in, Parker Nolan, he's been extremely impressive. He's a guy that has the ability to control the zone. Like, he doesn't chase, he doesn't expand. You know, he was consistently hitting balls 108, 110 backside, like in the backside gap, crushing balls. He's got a chance to be a very, very special player. When I watched him hit the very first day, I don't know, you're talking about NC State. We had a guy named Johnny Butler hitting our three hole, played left field for us every single day. Unbelievable player. He reminds me so much of Johnny Butler. That he's got a chance to be really special, you know. And you talk about Kennedy Jones. I mean, that guy, we've got a lot of guys that can really hit the baseball hard. I'll say that. It's just like anything, it's continuing to hone in approaches, make sure we're swinging at the right pitches, you know, because if we're not swinging at the right pitches, it doesn't matter if we can hit balls 115 or not. Like, we got to be able to swing at the right pitches to do damage with less than two strikes, to let that power play.
Go ahead, Will. My bad.
Well, I was just going to ask, I think you bring up such a fantastic point. Like, the guys coming back, it speaks for themselves. I'm interested as well to see how some opposing pitchers approach, you know, Petri, yeah. how much they're going to yeah. pitch to him type this year. Yeah. That's a whole other topic, coach. But for a guy like Kennedy Jones, like, when I looked at his frame, and he's a big guy, like, he fills out his frame. He's strong. Yeah. I guess the question when guys come into the SEC is, how are they going to adjust to SEC pitching? Is that a fair comment always to ask when guys go from lower levels to higher levels, coach?
Yeah, it is, for sure. You know, like, you're trying to bring in guys out of the portal, you know, that's a hard thing to figure out, you know, if they're going to be able to make that adjustment. It's the same thing recruiting high school guys into play in the SEC. Like, but, you know, I think that those dudes have acclimated pretty easily, to be honest with you. And that's one reason that we train so hard, too, is so that, you know, those dudes can get comfortable hitting those 95 mile an hour fastballs off the machine and the sweeping sliders, you know, every single day. It's not where we're inner squatting today. Let's just hope, you know, let's use today, see if he can start getting adjusted to this. No, like, it's from the day he stepped foot on campus, all those guys from the day they stepped foot on campus, and we set up practice in the cages and the field and whatever, like, it's immediately challenging and hard, so that when those guys face our SEC pitching staff, you know, during scrimmages, like, it's nothing they have never seen, if not maybe even a little less.
I love talking baseball. It's because he popped. Go ahead, Will.
Well, since we're already talking about guys, I just want to bring up another guy, Charlie. I'm sorry, because I like big.
That's okay.
I like big body guys, and this is a new big body guy. I just look at the roster: 6'6", 220 from the left side. Big Tyler, is it Cossie? Cossie from North Carolina, and I look at his background, and this is a high profile recruit. Didn't get a ton of action with the Tar Heels, but man, that's a guy who could probably just punish some baseballs as well with his size and his frame, and another transfer who could be, you know, a guy who's potentially going to be in the mix for you guys, I'm sure. A high-profile recruit coming out of high school.
Yeah, yeah, he's got a chance to be in that lineup every single day. Like, he had a really, really good fall, you know, and I mentioned it earlier, like talking about building relationships with these guys before we start attacking some of their weaknesses so that we can help them become more well-rounded. All these guys have one piece of their game that they need to continue to improve to be that well-rounded player that can make them that, you know, that legitimate first round pick and play for a long, long time. You know, and Causey has, you know, he has one maybe small thing that we're going to continue to work at, but there's some serious, serious, serious tools there. And he's got a chance to be in that lineup every single day.
So, Coach, we're talking about all these guys, and they're obviously very talented and will, for my money, succeed at the college level. But I would love to get your side of the story for as a hitting coach. What do you do or say to guys? And it's obviously situationless. Everybody struggles with different things. But we all know playing baseball, it's a long season. At some point, you're not going to be playing well. How do you go about helping your hitters when they're struggling or in a rut like that? How do you go about helping them get out of that or at least even diagnose what might be the problem?
Well, I think that, like, I think you try to attack that before it even happens, in my opinion. Okay. You know, like, I think about different things. Like, you know, like, every hitter has, like, there'll be like one drill, one swing thought, one external goal. There'll be one thing that, like, they need to do every single day to keep them dialed in and feeling good. So you have to try to stay on top of that and have them doing these things every single day in small group, one-on-one environments. Like, take a guy in the cage, like, let's spend 10 minutes. Let's do your stuff that helps you stay dialed in so that we're preventing those slumps from happening. You know, they're going to come, but you try to avoid them the best that you can. You want to be more proactive than reactive. Like, you don't want to wait for a guy to start struggling, then you take him into the cage, and then now, like, we're trying to play catch up. Yeah. So you're constantly trying to be proactive and prevent that and keep his swing in a good place. Then, like, you know, and then, like, the other side of it too is, like, being extremely well-rounded. Like, we talk to our guys all the time. Like, we've got a chance to have a really, really good lineup, really good lineup. But we don't want to be the best hitting team in the country. We don't. We want to be the best offensive team in the country. So, yeah. Like, we want to be able to, you know, put down drag bunts. We want to be able to safety. We want to be able to sacrifice. We want to be able to pressure you with all short game. If you're going to play back at third base, like, you're going to pay for it. If you're going to play in at third base, we're going to smoke it by you. If we're going to draw our walks, we're going to be very selective. We're not going to chase out of the zone. We're going to be, you know, when we get to first base, like, you're going to be on high alert at all times because we could have the chance to steal at any pitch. You know, you bury the breaking ball, you know, to Cole Messina, like, we're going to take advantage of the ball in dirt. So, like, you better not bury the breaking ball to Cole Messina. You leave it up, he's going to hammer it. So, like, we want to be able to apply pressure, you know, no matter what's happening. So we want to be the best offense. And so, you know, like, there's going to be times where we're going to be, you know, we're not going to, maybe we can't swing it as well. Maybe we're facing, like, you know, a number one from an SEC school that's going to really be able to shove, and he's going to be lights out. Well, like, we can't just stand in the box and swing. Like, we have to have plan B. We have to have plan C. And those are the ways to break down elite level pitching, is to be well-rounded in all facets of the game, not just standing in the box and swinging.
Yeah, that's a really good point. Coach, you're also dropping some gems today. Like, the fact you telling us, the Link Jarrett saying, don't get on the bus just for the ride. That's t-shirt material right there.
Yeah.
And then we're not the best hitting team. We're the best offensive team. That's another, yeah. Oh, these are good. I'll just steal them from you for a little, for the tweets.
We will. And one other thing is, you know, you talk about units, right? Offense, and then the other unit, right? The pitching staff, the defense. And I know we're primarily focusing on offense with you and how you're doing all you can to make South Carolina the best offense possible. I'm with Charlie. I love your approach to that. But I also think, you know, in the game of baseball, iron sharpens iron a little bit, right? Those guys facing Jack Mahoney and Will Sanders last year, I'm sure helped them. With those guys gone and not maybe with, you know, you lose your top three inning getters from a year ago, is there a little pressure on the offense to say, hey, we got to be the ones to cook a little bit more? Because the pitching was a big strength of the team last year, top 10 in the country in ERA, but without the top three guys, at least from last year's club in innings.
No, you're right. You're right. So going into the fall, there was, you know, it was a lot of unspoken, like we're going to have to score runs to carry this team to have a chance to win. But what happened is, like, offense continued to get better, but as you watch those guys, every time they ran out there to that mound, those guys got a little bit better and a little bit better and a little bit better. And so honestly, like when you got to the end of the fall, our pitchers were holding their own against our hitters. It was pretty impressive. Those guys got better every time they went out. Matt Williams has done an unbelievable job with these guys. We've got some freshmen. We got some transfers. Those dudes are rolling out there. And at the end of the fall, they may have even gotten the best of some of our better hitters in the World Series.
Ooh, I like him.
There's some
like
good him. Arms on there too, for sure. I'm excited for Big Eli Jones. So yes. I mean, you know, he can run it up there. So
yeah, he's good, man. He is really good, man. He's sinking and running it. He's got that little cutter slider that's firm. Like, it's good.
You guys have some great baseball names on South Carolina too. Just like, this just sounds like a ball player. Like Eli Jones. It's like that guy's throwing cheddar for sure. We talked about it a little bit, Coach. I'm just curious because I've not asked. We've had like a bunch of coaches on this podcast now at this point. I know I've never asked this, but so you talked a little bit about transfers and then high schoolers and like, you know, worry about how they transition to the SEC possibly. Is recruiting from the transfer portal versus high school totally different, or is it fairly similar?
No, you know, honestly, like when you're recruiting the high school players, like you were trying to recruit like the best high school players possible.
Yeah.
When you're, you know, like you're trying to go get these high profile guys, these guys that are, you know, well established, that have had a ton of success, are extremely athletic. Like, you know, you're going to be battling the draft to get them on campus. When it comes to the portal, like those are typically guys that you know you're trying to get the best players possible in the portal, but you're also trying to fill specific individual needs. And so you're trying to think through like, okay, like we just lost this, like we need somebody to come in, step in, that can play this position every day. You know, we don't really need this, so we're going to pass on that guy, even though he's a really, really good player. Now if he's a junior in high school, like we're probably not passing on him. So, you know, when you're looking at the portal, you're thinking more about what are my immediate needs, who can come in and make an immediate impact. When you're recruiting high school, you're thinking more long-term future.
Okay, yeah, that makes sense.
Yeah. No, that is big time. Coach, I love talking with you today. Appreciate that you've been able to take time to join us. I know we've wanted to get you on for quite some time. Yes. We're excited for you, you know, jumping on board to South Carolina now this year. And man, we're really looking forward, and we're feeling bad for the opposing pitching staffs because that offense looks great. Like you said, the arm's doing great things, and it's always a good day when you get Charlie Bornoff fired up, and I believe you've done that today, Coach. So thank you so much.
Real before we go, well, Coach, I have a couple of rapid fire questions for you. That's okay. All right, first one, I ask everybody this: what's your favorite Pop Tart?
I'm honestly a very plain guy. I don't venture out, like I don't experiment much. I just stick to the most basic thing and try not to make too many complicated decisions.
Okay. what's your favorite flavor then? What's your
blueberry.
Blueberry. Okay.
Blueberry. Man.
Blueberry. Gotcha. Okay. And then next one, biggest baseball pet peeve, either as a player or a coach.
Ooh.
Like I remember in high school, our head coach, I thought he was going to kill us a couple of times. We'd be picking up balls and we'd leave like two out on accident. He would,
or dudes running back to the dugout after they strike out.
Shout out Coach Ravy.
That's a tough one. I would say, hitting with some guys and just leaving and letting them pick up the balls is a pet peeve for sure.
There you go. Last one. What was your walk-up song in college? Or if you didn't have one, what would it have been?
It was pretty bad taste. I look back at it. It was one of the Kid Rock songs. I can't remember the name of it, but yeah, it was honestly like it was something to try to get me all fired up. And I was a bad player. I was a singles hitting catcher with no tools my only tool was I could run. And it really wasn't that good. So
a fast catcher. Interesting.
Yeah. Singles hitting fast catcher.
There we go. That's a unique skill set though. I like that.
Are you working? What kind of work do you do?